Hey, hi guys. Hello, everybody. So today we have to take the chapter of the transportation in the plants, right? So which chapter we have to begin today? We have to begin the chapter of the transportation in the plants. I think that is the last chapter that is left for you all, right? So let's, good evening, everybody. Good evening. Yes. So transportation in the plants is also very interesting. You know, it is it's quite an interesting chapter. So we'll be doing the details of the transportation. It has got a lot of topics like, you know, transpiration, imbibition, then diffusion, facilitated diffusion, water potential, and lot of related topics that would be useful for the, the NEET mainly, right? So let us begin with that. Okay. So I'm just doing the screen share as usual, and we'll be explaining it in length, explaining in detail. Right, there are a lot of basics topics. These topics are like fundamental, so you need to understand them properly and, you know, accurately. Okay, so here we go. The name of the chapter in the GTB. See, I'm not doing for GTB. I'm doing from the. Yes, sir. Sushmita, ma'am, you're raising your hand. Yeah, so it is in the GTBC, transportation in plants. You know, the particular chapter is not in the GTB, it is in the NCERT, right? And under GTB, it is a different chapter. So we'll be doing this exclusively through the NCERT from the, you know, obviously from the NEET point of view. Okay, so transportation in plants is a separate topic, right? You know, chapter number 11. It is in the 11th standard, transportation in plants. Comes under the 11th standard NCERT, chapter number 11, right? In the plant water relation. Okay. Yeah. In the GTB, if you're asking, it is like plant water relations, chapter number 6. Plant water relations, chapter number 6. Okay. It will be by the name plant water relations, chapter number 6. Okay, so I'm just doing the screen share. So we have to cover up how many topics. So these are the topics that we have to cover. So these are so many of the topics that we have to cover is the means of transport, plant water relations, long distance transport of water, right? Transpiration, uptake and transportation of mineral nutrients, and the phloem, right? So all these topics we have to discuss in detail.
Okay, so now see, we all, this topic is just initial part. We all know that it is about the plants, like, you know, plants need energy to move, you know, for very long distances. They need energy for, you know, for transportation of water, for transportation of food, for doing photosynthesis also. So we have to understand, you know, how the plants transport the materials. You know, we have to understand the basics of diffusion. And, you know, flowering plants need water, they need nutrients, right? They need hormones. So transportation, you all know this word from your schoolings, that transportation, you know, over long distances proceeds through the vascular system, that is called as what, translocation. So you all have heard about this translocation, right? So what do you mean by the word translocation? Translocation is a basic concept in which, you know, the water is transported over long distances, you know, and that is by means of the translocation. Translocation is for transportation of food and water. Water is obviously transported through the xylem, and the food components, they are transported across via the phloem. Right? So all these things you are aware of. So water, you know, water is transported in unidirection. What is unidirectional? It is transported from roots to the stem. So for transportation of water, it occurs through the xylem and it is unidirectional. But however, for phloem, you know, it is multidirectional, because food is transported in upwards as well as the downward directions. You all are aware of it, that the food transport occurs, you know, it is, yes, it is upwards as well as it is downwards. That's correct. Okay, so we'll go to the main things, like, you know, hormones and all. You all know that, you know, what is the meaning of the word polar direction? Like, there are some hormones which are transported in the, they show polarity, strictly polarized. What is the meaning of polarity? Hormones are transported from the morphological, you know, apex to the base, right? Polarity, they show the polarity, like, you know, they are transported from the apical parts to the basal parts. That is called as the polarity. So they are also transported in unidirectional manner. So let us understand what are the means of this transport. This earlier part was just the introduction. No question coming from it. So we all know what is diffusion, right, guys? Everyone knows what is diffusion. Substances, you know, they can go from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration is known as what? Diffusion. And it was all in the school that we had done. So diffusion is basically passive. So why it is called passive? Because, you know, it occurs from one cell, one part of the cell to the other part of the cell, and it can occur only over short distance. Right? So it can occur only over the short distances. And remember, when we say the word passive, that means there is no expenditure of energy. So there is no energy expenditure taking place for the diffusion. So in the diffusion, you know, the molecules move in a random fashion. So in what fashion they are moving? They are moving in a random fashion. The net result being, you know, they are moving from regions of the higher concentration to the regions of the lower concentrations, right? So diffusion is, like, you know, we all know it is from the higher level to the lower level, and the molecules are going in a random fashion from higher end to the lower end, and it is just passive. It is without the expenditure of energy. So there is no energy expenditure, and it is purely a passive process, right? It is entirely a passive process, though it is a slow process, and it is not dependent on a living system. That is very important. So what we do not require is, we do not require a living system for diffusion. What we don't want is, we do not require a cell membrane. So diffusion can happen for all, you know, it can happen for solids also, it can happen for liquids also, it can happen for the gases also. So there is no, like, you know, osmosis is only for liquid. You all know that, no? Osmosis is only for the liquid, but diffusion can occur for solids also, liquids also, and gases also. So diffusion is obvious in gases and liquids, but diffusion in solids is more likely rather than of solids. Because diffusion of solid is some very odd concept. Like, how can solid diffuse? Diffusion can happen rather inside the solids. So diffusion is a very important process to the plants, since it is the only means for the gaseous transport. You all know that how the, you've done in the photosynthesis, how the, you know, stomatas and all, how the gases, oxygen, carbon dioxide exchange for the light reaction, dark reaction, you know, during respiration. right? So they are the only means, this is very important, is the only means for the gaseous movement within the plant body, right? So diffusion is a very important concept, mainly for the plants. And diffusion rates are affected by the, you know, concentration gradient, by the permeability separating them. So diffusion is affected by, you know, the temperatures. Temperatures affect diffusion, pressure affect the diffusion, concentration gradient will obviously affect, because diffusion is movement of substances from the higher concentration to the lower concentration, right? So it is affected by all these steps. Okay, so now let's talk about diffusion called as the facilitated diffusion. So what do you mean by the word facilitated? Facilitated means what? With the help of something. To facilitate something. To facilitate means what? Like to help, like facilitation. So as pointed out earlier, you know, gradient must already be present for diffusion to occur. So for diffusion to occur, there has to be a gradient. Like, you know, one should be at a higher level, one should be at a lower level. Without gradient, you know, it cannot happen. So the diffusion rate, the rate of diffusion depends upon, again, the size of substance, right? Smaller substances diffuse faster. The same is for biotechnology. If you remember in biotech, during the technique of the electrophoresis, right? Wasn't it there that these smaller DNA molecule fragment, or they separate earlier than the, you know, larger DNA segments. So here too, you know, the size matters, because the smaller substances diffuse faster as compared to the larger ones. And they also depend upon the concentration gradient. So diffusion of, you know, any substance across a membrane also depends upon its solubility. Yes. Why it depends upon solubility? It all depends upon the solubility in the lipids. Now, what can you connect to? Can anyone connect to any other mechanism, like, you know, where solubility in lipids was a very important concern for, you know, where else we have done this concept of the lipid solubility? Anyone? So solubility of, you know, lipids was a very important factor for certain substances. Like if you remember the hormones, like, you know, the hormones which are lipid soluble, and that solubility of lipid was a very important factor, because some hormones were lipid soluble, and being lipid soluble, they could easily, you know, cross the cell membrane, they could enter the cell, and they straight away act on the genome, they could straight away form a hormone receptor complex with the nuclear membrane. We're making a hormone complex with which membrane? With the nuclear membrane. So that was pretty important. So which hormones were lipid soluble? Perfect. Thyroxine. One is the thyroxine and the other one is the steroid hormones. So steroid hormones as well as the thyroid, you know, they are the lipid, they are lipid soluble. So here was the concept why lipid solubility is an important factor. Okay, protoplasm, you know, the cytoplasm contains also lipids. So hormone action also depends upon the lipid solubility. Correct. And to go further in the facilitated diffusion, so the facilitated diffusion is pretty important, because substances soluble in lipids diffuse through the membrane faster, and substances that have high, you know, hydrophilic moiety, you know, find it difficult to pass through the membrane, right? Hydrophilic, like water soluble. So their movement has to be facilitated. lipid soluble can go fast, they can like zoom, but the other ones, you know, they require some help, and that help is called as a facilitation. So membrane proteins, you know, which are the proteins, the membrane proteins, you know, they provide the sites at which these molecules cross the membrane. So who are going to, you know, help, who will help in the facilitated diffusion? There are some membrane proteins, proteins at the cell membrane, you know, which form the hormone receptor complex. Do you remember? Right? They will provide the sites at which these molecules can cross the membrane. So they are already, they already be present, you know, they are already present for molecules to diffuse, even if facilitated by the protein. So this type of diffusion in which it is facilitated with the help of certain membrane proteins, that is called as a facilitated diffusion. So I hope you are very clear with what is facilitated diffusion. Diffusion across the cell membrane with the help of certain carrier proteins of membrane proteins is known as the facilitated diffusion. So in the facilitated diffusion, you know, special proteins help to move the substances across, and that is obviously with the expenditure of energy. So here, what we have to spend the energy out here. So the facilitated diffusion causes, you know, net transport of molecules from, you know, lower to a higher concentration. So facilitated diffusion can be both the ways. It can be from higher to lower also, and it can be from lower to higher also. Right? So lower to higher is very rare though. So facilitated diffusion cannot cause net transport of molecules, as this would require input of energy. You all know that active and passive transport. I hope you all are aware of active transport and the passive transport. Whenever substances are going from their higher concentration to their lower concentration, that is called passive without the ATP. And whenever substances are going from their lower concentration to their higher concentration, that is called as active transport, and that requires ATP because it is against the concentration gradient. And these concepts you have, you know, learnt about. You have learnt about these concepts when we studied the excretion osmoregulation, where the active transport, passive transport was involved, right? Reabsorption was involved, right? So transport rate reaches a maximum when all of the protein transporters are being used. So transportation will be fast if all receptor proteins they are being used. So there should be saturation. So saturation will only be attained when all the receptor molecules are doing their work, when they're doing their job. And when all of them, they are taking part in the transportation. So you can see here a very nice diagram to show the facilitated diffusion, right? So you can see the substances are moving, you know, the proteins are being carried, like, you know, from the outer side of the cell. So if, for example, this is a substance. So you can see that it is being carried from the outer part to the inner part, right? The blue substance is being transported from the outer region to the inner region. Right, so these are the substances, you know, they are passing from the outer side of the cell and they're moving to the inner part, right? So from the outer end, they're transported, you know, inside the cell. And this is the carrier protein. Which one is the carrier protein? The pink one. This pink one here acts as a carrier protein. So it is helping in the facilitation. So it's helping for the facilitated diffusion. Right. So it is very specific. So it allows these cells to select substances for the uptake. So the proteins, you know, they form channels. I told you, you know, they are forming like, you know, channels to for the molecules to be passed through. So proteins, what they do is that they pass. There are like channels. You can see the protein channels out here. So they are being transported. So some channels are always open and others can be controlled. Right. So some are large channels allowing, you know, variety of molecules. Like for bigger molecules also, some channels are always open so that the substances can be transported, you know, properly. So there are some, you know, things called as porins. The porins are proteins that form large pores in the outer membranes of the plastids, of the mitochondria, of the some bacterial, allowing molecules, right, up to the size of small proteins to pass through. So porins, you know, they are generated, or porins are created, you know, for basically for passage of the substances. Porins are secreted because, you know, they cause the gaps in the membrane for transportation of the substances, for, you know, selective proteins to be transported properly. Here I'm coming to the picture to give you, yeah. The figure 11.1 shows an extracellular molecule bond to the transport protein. The transport protein then rotates and releases the molecule inside the cell, like, you know, like water channels. They're made up of 8 different types of aquaporins. So why aqua? Because they are porins for the transportation. Like you can see the, by the word aqua, because of water, right? So the extracellular molecule is bound to the transport protein, right? Then it rotates and it sends it to the inside. So here, this is the aqua. Yeah, here you can see the molecule is getting attached and this is going to go inside. So it is going to rotate itself. You can see this end was on the, this was at the right hand side. Now it is rotated and it's gone to the left hand side. So it is transported, you know, transported molecule is to the inner of the cell. So it receives it at the outer end, right? And then transports to the inner side. So such type are called as what? They are called as the aquaporins. Now the word porins, you know, we had the word porins in the immunity also. Anyone can explain where this porin concept was there in immunity? Yeah, so who would like to try where this concept was there? The similar concept was there when we, about the porins. So let's see who can solve, who can tell me, come on. Yeah, the one. Hey guys, we had this porin concept about the immunity when the pores are created by the killer T lymphocytes. Don't you remember? There are some, you know, killer T cells. The killer T cells, what they do is that they secrete porins, which cause pores in the, they cause pores in the cell membrane of the bacteria. So what are they doing? They are creating pores, no, in the membranes of the bacteria. And then they send their toxins inside, right? Do you remember this, right? So they send, the toxins are, you know, released because of the pores that they create in the cell membrane. And then that is why they are called as cytotoxic cells or killer T lymphocytes. So again, the word porin was there here. And one more place, the word porin was there for the action of B lymphocytes. How the B lymphocytes act,
you know, opsonization, you know, so porins are important for immunity also, for transportation or to create gaps in the cell membrane, either for helping in transport or either to, you know, kill the bad cells, to kill the germs. So even for that, it is quite useful. All right.
Okay, so we go further now for so the next concept that we are heading out to the passive symports and the antiports. Okay, this diagram is pretty important. So what do you mean by the word passive symport? So certain, you know, some carrier proteins, what they do is that there are certain carrier proteins or transport proteins, they allow diffusion only if two types of molecules move together, right? So there are some proteins, they allow diffusion only if both the molecules, if two types of molecules are moving together, then and then only they are going to allow. Right? So in a symport, both molecules, sim means what, together. In symport, what happens? Both the molecules cross the membrane in the same direction. And in antiport, they move in the opposite direction. As simple as that. So symports means what? In the same direction. Antiports means what? In the opposite direction. So you could see the symport and the antiport. What is the meaning of the word uniport, guys? Uniport means what? When a molecule moves across a membrane independent of other molecules, then it can move singly. When it is single, it doesn't depend on others. Then it is called as what? Then it is called as a uniport. All right. So here, these are the diagrams for clarity. So that being the uniport, why it is uniport? Because it is carrying singly. It doesn't require any other help. So that is a uniport. Why this is an antiport? Because one substance is moving in one direction, the other one is moving in the opposite direction. So then it is called as what? Then it is called as an antiport. And what do you mean by the word symport? When both the substances are moving in the same direction. So when they are moving across in the same direction, then it is called as what? It is called as a symport. Uniport, I'll tell you what is a uniport. Yeah, I'll tell you what is a uniport. Just see what is this in a uniport. See here, anti means what? There are two substances. There is substance A and there is substance B. So there are what, two substances and they are moving in opposite directions. So then it is called as an antiport. Symport means what? When both the substances, you know, A and B, they're moving in the same direction. Right? And in uniport, uni means one. So here there are no two substances. Here there is no rule that both the substances have to be transported together. For antiport and symport, it is a rule that two substances should cross, or they should, you know, they should get transported together, either in the same direction for, as in for symport, or in the opposite directions as in for the antiport. But in uniport, only one substance could be transported. There is no rule or there is no compulsion that two things have to go, you know, move along together. Yeah, understood? There is no compulsion of two substances moving together. Did you get it now? Only any one can also go. So they are not dependent on the other substances. So that is why it is called as what? It is called as a uniport. So in uniport, you can see here only substance A is getting transported. There is no substance B involved in the picture. Okay, perfect. Okay, now this is something that we always did. We have done so many times. Active transport. What is active transport? Is it useful? Yes. Yeah. So what do you mean by the word, you know, active transport? So the active transport is the one, like, you know, it uses energy to transport and pump molecules against the concentration gradient. So whenever something is going, you know, against the concentration gradient, it is called as an active transport. So, you know, different proteins play a role in both active as well as passive. Pumps are proteins that are used, you know, pumps, protein pumps are there that they use the energy to carry substances. Like, you know, we have the, for neurons, we have something called as a sodium pump. For muscle, we have calcium pump, sodium potassium pump, right? So these pumps, you know, we require pumps to transport substances from lower concentration to the higher concentration. That is like an uphill transport. What is the meaning of uphill? So if you're going uphill, we will require more energy. And for going downhill, it is more easier. So it is called as like what? It is called as an uphill transport. Yeah, very good, Himanshu. Very good. Yes, Komal. Perfect. The sodium, potassium, right. Low to high. So like it's as simple as that. Now when we are, if you are swimming against the current of water, you will require more energy to swim than what you will require while you are swimming along the current of the water. So it's as simple as that. Like, okay. So transportation rates, you know, will reach their maximum, you know, when all proteins are, I told you, know, when it will be, when the transport will become maximum, when all protein transporters are being used or they get saturated. And the, so like the enzymes, the carrier proteins, it is very specific. So like enzymes, the carrier proteins are also specific in what they carry across the membrane. So these proteins are sensitive to inhibitors that react with the protein side chains. So like, you know, there are some inhibitors which don't allow these, you know, those substances to be transported. Like for enzymes also, if you remember, there were some inhibitors called as the competitive and non-competitive inhibitors. Same way, like, you know, enzymes are also inhibited. They were, you remember that in the enzyme ka part, that enzymes, you know, the substrate attaches to the enzyme at the binding site, active site, right? But there were some inhibitors which were not allowing the substrate to get attached to the active site or the binding site. So they were called as the competitive inhibitors. So like that, they were the non-competitive inhibitors as well, like cyanide. During passive, energy is not used. During passive transport, energy is not utilized. Because it is passive, no, it is along the concentration gradient. Energy will be needed for active and not so for the passive. So let us compare, you know, different transport processes. So as we are saying, you know, proteins in the membrane are responsible for facilitated diffusion and active transport, and hence common characters of being highly selective, liable to saturate, respond to inhibitors under hormonal conditions, right? So remember, but diffusion, whether facilitated or not, you know, takes place only along a concentration gradient and does not use energy. Remember, this active transport is very different from diffusion. Diffusion is always passive, so it does not use energy. Okay, so don't get confused. Active and passive. Active uses energy, passive does not use energy. And passive can be of two types, you know, like normal diffusion or facilitated diffusion. Both do not require energy. Facilitated is just because they require some carrier proteins like we saw in symport, antiport and all. Okay, so they don't require energy. So to make things simple for us, they have given this nice table. So passive will not require energy. Okay. Yeah. So let us understand this. So requires special membrane proteins. Who requires this membrane proteins? Does simple diffusion require membrane proteins? Definitely not. Does facilitated transport require these, these membrane proteins? Definitely yes. And what about active transport? Also yes. Right? They require these proteins, you know, for transportation. Are they highly selective? In simple diffusion, are the molecules like, you know, selective? Are the proteins selected? No. But for facilitated transport as well as active transport, they are very selective. Like, you know, antigens and antibodies, like, you know, antibodies only are selective to antigens. Hormones are target specific. You know, that is called selectiveness. Enzymes are specific towards substrates. So it is like that. Selective nature. Transport saturates, right? So are there saturates required or formed in simple diffusion? No, but for facilitated active, yes. Because more the saturation, better the transport. Right? Why there are saturates? Because they require proteins. No, proteins only need to be saturated. Remember, things move faster when all the carrier proteins are saturated. So proteins are required. Membrane proteins are required only in facilitated and active, no? So there only the question of saturation comes. In simple diffusion, there is no membrane proteins. So question of saturation of, these proteins do not arise. Uphill transport is obviously no for simple diffusion. Again, no for facilitated. Facilitated also is like passive. It does not require energy. Just I told you, no, it is also from higher to lower concentration. For active, yes, it is uphill transport. And what about requires ATP? So simple diffusion, no ATP required. Facilitated, no ATP required. And for active, yes, ATP is definitely required. Yes, so the table is quite clear, right? Pretty nice table to, you know, clear all the basics. So are we clear? Sure. Okay, so now the plant water relations. So this is like a new part here. So what is this part? This part is called as the plant water relations. So what is the relation of plants with water? Obviously, water is life, so everything is related to them. So as we see, you know, water is essential for all activities of the plants and plays an important role, right? So it provides us a medium for which, you know, substances. So it's a universal solvent. And the protoplasm, as I told you, the protoplasm of cells is nothing but water in which different molecules are dissolved, right? And they are suspended. So it is, protoplasm is nothing but water. You know, it's the living substance. What is protoplasm? I hope you know the definition of protoplasm. It is called as a life substance or the living substance. So living substance, who else will tell me something about the, anyone? Anything else you can share about the protoplasm? Yeah, perfect. So protoplasm is the life substance. It is made up of nucleus and cytoplasm. What is the protoplasm made up of? It is made up of the nucleus plus the cytoplasm. So protoplasm is very important. It's composed of two things. So one is the nucleus and second one is the cytoplasm. They form protoplasm. It is a life substance, the living part of the cell. So whatever thing which is alive in the cell, it is the protoplasm. Right? So water is essential for all the physiological activities, plays a very important role, provides a medium, right? So protoplasm of the cells is nothing but water only. So like, for example, a watermelon is 92% water. Most herbaceous plants have only around 10 to 15% of its fresh weight as dry matter. So even the herbaceous plants, only their dry weight is around 10 to 15%. Apart from that, everything is water only. Even human body is what, around 70% water, right? So the distribution of water, you know, within a plant varies. Woody parts have less water, soft parts like, you know, pulp, fruits, inflorescence, succulent leaves, they've got more water. You have studied all in the morphology chapter, right? Nice chapter of morphology, you've studied all these basics. So they're trying to see that a seed may be appearing water, otherwise it would not be alive and respiring. So even though the seed may be very dry, but it still has water, you know, otherwise it would not be alive or respiring. You know, what are the dry seeds called as? Who will tell me? It was there in one chapter of the 12th standard. What are the dry seeds called as? Anyone? Dry seeds are called as what? They are called as the drupe. Very good. Sia, perfect. Achha. There is one more word is there. They are also called as, not coming here. Dry seeds are also called as recalcitrant seeds. Are you aware of that? Okay, what are the dry seeds also known as? They are known as the recalcitrant seeds. They are also known as what? They are known as the recalcitrant seeds. That's the word for the dry seeds. Okay, great, Himanshu. Yeah, so terrestrial plants take up huge amount of water daily, but like you all know about transpiration, right? You had the entire chapters of transpiration in the, if you belong to the ICC board, you know, IG, CBC, even SSC had this, every board had this. So even a mature corn plant, you know, absorbs almost 3 liters of water in a day, while a mustard absorbs water equal to its own weight. So why is there's always high demand for water. So it is not surprising that water is often a limiting factor for plant growth and productivity. What do you mean by limiting factor? Blackman's law of limiting factors. I hope you know what I'm saying. So what do you mean by this word called limiting factor? Like if in photosynthesis, like, you know, for productivity, water is most limiting factor. So like there are 4 raw materials of photosynthesis. Which are the 4 raw materials? Carbon dioxide, right? You know, water, sunlight, and chlorophyll. So the factor which is the least, what does the law of limiting factor say? That out of these 4 factors, the one factor which is the least available, that decides, you know, the productivity. So the factor which is least available, that decides the productivity. So the water is most of the times, because see, carbon dioxide is always there. In fact, the CO2 levels in they are increasing day by day. Carbon dioxide levels are on the rise, right? So CO2 levels are definitely on the rise. then chlorophyll is there in the plants, right? Sunlight is obviously there. So water is the only limiting factor. Okay, now we'll do something about the water potential before heading out to the osmosis. Correct. So to comprehend, you know, the plant water relations and understanding, so let us understand the words, like, you know, this is water potential is a concept fundamental to understanding the water movement. Right? Whatever I've underlined is very, very important. Water potential is called psi W. I hope you know that symbol is what? Psi. Looks like the Trishul, right? So you use it in physics, I suppose, right? Psi. So water potential, psi W, is a concept which is fundamental to understanding the movement of water, right? So water potential is called as what? Let's see the concepts, okay? Water potential is psi W, right? So it helps us to understand how the water moves. So there are two things important. One is a solute ka potential and one is a pressure ka potential. Solute means obviously the thing that gets dissolved in the solvent, because water is a solvent. So things that dissolve in it, they are a solute. So solute potential is psi S for solute, and water potential is psi W for water, and pressure potential is psi P for pressure, right? So let's understand the concept. So water molecules possess which energy? The kinetic energy. When water obviously can't be statue, right? It has to flow, so it possesses kinetic energy. In liquids and gases form, they're in random motion, that is both random and constant also. Like water flows in gaseous form, it's in the form of vapor, right? So greater the concentration of water in a system, greater is the kinetic energy of the water ka potential. As simple as that. So more the water in any system, right, more is the kinetics. So that's the reason, guys, do you know, we need to drink more water. Are you understanding why people say drink more water? Because more the concentration of water in a system, like for example, as a doctor, I will tell you, I tell so many of my patients, you know, I have to tell them, I have to request them, drink water, because they come up with complaints like, you know, dehydration and, you know, hair fall and dry skin and constipation and, you know, somewhere or the other, you know, pimples, somewhere or the other, it's connected to water. I can't explain my patients all this stuff, but this we know that more the concentration of water we have, right, the more will be the kinetic energy or the water potential. And more the potential of water in our body, the more it will be better for the systems to be healthy. So it is obvious that pure water will have the greatest potential, obviously, because pure water is pure, right? So it is pure concentration. Remember, the purity of water was connected with, there was a certain chapter called as the microbes in human welfare, where you did the part of BOD. BOD, biochemical oxygen demand of water, right, to determine the purity. So what is good, to have high BOD or to have low BOD? What is good to have, a higher BOD or to have a low BOD? Right, so yeah, so who has answered, to have a higher BOD is useful or low BOD? Very good, Komal. Low BOD is good. Biochemical oxygen demand is a demand of oxygen, you know, that is demanded by bacteria to degrade the pollution. So it is better to have a lower BOD. So, okay, so what we understood here is that it is obvious, like, you know, pure water will have the highest water potential. So if two systems containing water are in direct contact, right, so water movement of water molecules will result in net movement of water molecules from system with higher energy to one with lower energy. Right, so it's so simple. So whenever two water systems are in contact, the water will move from that system which has higher water concentration or higher water potential to the another system which will have a little lower water potential. right? And the process of movement down the gradient, you know, this is by diffusion. It is simple diffusion, free of energy. So water potential is denoted by Greek symbol psi, Trishul, like, you know, and it is expressed in pressure units like pascals. So by convention, you know, the water potential of pure water at standard temperature is taken to be zero. Remember, what is the water potential of pure water, right? Pure water, the water potential at standard temperature, and which is not under any pressure. It is just standard, like that is taken to be zero. So for pure water, the water potential is zero. But if some solute is dissolved in this pure water, the solution has fewer free water molecules and the concentration of water decreases. Right? So I told you, water potential of pure water is the most. So now what will happen here is that if some solutes or like impurities get dissolved in that water, then the fewer water molecules will be less. So the concentration of water will decrease, and more, and you know, the concentration of water is directly proportional to its potential. So whenever some solutes get dissolved in the water, right? So water potential will decrease, right? Because the concentration will lower, no? Decreasing concentration will cause decrease in the water potential. So hence all solutions, you know, have lower water potential than pure water. It is obvious. Solutions the water potential will be lower than the pure water, and the magnitude of this lowering due to the dissolution of solute is called as a solute potential. So obviously solute potential will be always negative only. Why? Solute potential, because what is the water potential? Water potential of pure water is zero. So solute ka potential is always lower, na? Lower than the pure water ka potential. Pure water, the water potential of pure water is zero. So obviously solute potential of, you know, water is going to be negative because it is always lower. So, and more the solutes, the more we add the solutes, you know, the more the negativity, because obviously, you know, the lesser the free water molecules will be less. So as simple as that, like, you know, that the water potential of pure water where there is no solute will be zero. And if any solutes are added, the water potential reduces. So it goes into negative. And more the solutes we add, you know what happens is that it still becomes more and more negative. Right? Because the water concentration is decreasing. No, free water molecules are decreasing. That is the reason. Right? So for a solution at atmospheric pressure, right? So solution at what? Atmospheric pressure. The water potential is equal to the solute potential. See, always remember, for pure water, what is the potential of pure water under zero pressure or under no pressure? See, which is not under any pressure. Water potential of pure water is zero. Understand, guys, this part very important. The water potential is zero, but it is at zero pressure, like without any pressure. But here we are seeing that the water potential at atmospheric pressure is always equal to the solute potential. Did you understand why? Because this is the water potential, not, it is at atmospheric pressure. It would have been zero. Yes, I know water potential would have been zero, right? But it would have been zero at what state? At zero pressure. But atmospheric pressure is there, right? So now the psi W will be equal to psi S. That means the potential, the water potential will be equal to the solute potential at atmospheric pressure. For pure water under no pressure, obviously psi W is more, that is zero, and psi S is negative. But that is for pure water. That is for pure water, not for solutions. And also under zero pressure. It is also under zero pressure. And if a pressure, you know, greater than the atmospheric pressure is applied to pure water or solution, obviously, now if you are applying a greater pressure, more than the atmospheric pressure is applied, you know, its water potential increases. So water potential will increase. So it is equivalent to pumping water from one place to another. So pressure can be built up in plant system, like, you know, where do the plants build pressure? Remember the turgor pressure in plants? Remember the transpiration pull? So these are all places where pressure is going to be developed. Like, you know, the turgor turgidity and all. So that we'll do later on. So guys, what did we understand? We understood that the water potential, the potential of water, right? Water potential is equal to solute potential, but at atmospheric pressure. But if the water potential, you know, what will happen is that the water potential will increase if there is a pressure more than the atmospheric pressure, right? Then the water potential increases. So pressure potential is usually positive, right? So pressure potential, so what is the pressure potential? It is always positive, though in plants, negative potential or tension in the water column plays an important role in, you know, the water transport. Like, do you remember ascent of sap in the plants? So pressure potential is called as what? Psi P. Right, pressure potential is called as what? The psi P. Right, so what is the pressure potential? It is the potential of water under greater atmospheric pressure. Right, it is the water potential under greater pressure, under pressures more than the atmospheric pressure. Right, making the cells turgid. So that is the pressure potential. So finally, you know, water potential of a cell is affected by both solute also and pressure potential also. Solutes, obviously, because more the solutes, what happens to the water potential? Tell me. How is the solute affecting the water potential? If the solutes are more, what is happening to the water potential? Is the water potential increasing or decreasing? So basically, guys, my question is, what is the relation of water potential with the solute? Directly proportional or inversely proportional? If the solute concentration is increasing, what will happen to the water potential? Will it increase or will it decrease? Very good, Ansh. Yeah, you're correct. It will definitely decrease only. Right? Because more the solutes, as I told you earlier, more the solutes, lesser the free water, and lesser the free water availability, the potential of water reduces. Water potential will definitely reduce. And what about the pressure potential? What is the relation with the pressure potential? Who will tell me the relation of water potential with the pressure potential? Is it directly proportional or is it inversely proportional? Yeah, very good, Ansh. Once again, it is directly proportional. It is directly proportional because obviously, pressure, if the atmospheric pressure, greater pressure, more than the atmospheric pressure is applied, the water potential becomes positive. So forget negative, it becomes positive, more than zero. So the relationship between them is followed like this. So relationship between them is, this is the final relationship, that is the psi W is equal to psi S plus psi P. So eventually, you know, both are affecting. You know, one is affecting directly, one is affecting inversely. So the net, I understand you have to find out net one. Like for effective filtration. So this is the effective one. One is favoring, one is decreasing. So psi S, that is solute potential is decreasing and the pressure potential is increasing. So whatever the net of that will be the water potential. So basically, if the solute potential is more, if the solute potential is more and the you know, the pressure potential is less, right? So the solute potential is more. It depends upon the additions of both of them. So this is the relation. The water potential is equal to the solute potential plus the pressure ka potential. Solute potential plus the pressure potential. Yeah, very good. Yeah, so why not we go to osmosis a little later and we check out. Yeah, so guys, here, you know, they have given us about certain things like diffusion, we already know, right? Movement of from higher to lower concentration is diffusion. Factors affecting the diffusion are temperature. So what are the factors that affect the diffusion? Is first is the temperature. So increase in temperature leads to increase in diffusion. So you can say that diffusion temperature is, you know, diffusion is directly proportional to the temperature. Pressure, again, rate of diffusion is more if the pressure is more. So again, the relation is directly proportional to the pressure. Size and mass of substance. So yes, now here it is inversely proportional. Why? Because if the mass is more, the diffusion is slow, right? You have discussed this. If the mass is more, or for higher molecules, the diffusion is slower, and for smaller molecules, the diffusion is faster. Density, obviously, it is again inversely proportional, because if the medium is already dense, it is already concentrated, the diffusion will be slow. So that's why gas will diffuse more in vacuum than in air. So diffusion will be the best in vacuum than in the air. Again, diffusion in gases will be faster than diffusion in the solutions. How is the diffusion affecting? The diffusion obviously affects the gaseous exchange, as I told you, for respiration and photosynthesis. Diffusion is also involved in transpiration of water vapor. So what are the mechanisms behind diffusion? Transpiration, photosynthesis, respiration. Even aroma of flowers is due to diffusion of these, their aromatic compounds, you know. It also helps in pollination also to attract the animals. Even for diffusion is very important for, you know, uptake of salt and ions also. Isn't diffusion also required? It's very important for us also, no? Even diffusion for animals. It is so important, like kidney, you know, that remember diffusion, selective reabsorption and all. Urine formation, it was so important. Diffusion helps in translocation of food materials across the phloem. It invariably helps in the translocation. So gaseous exchange in submerged hydrophytes. So the, you know, like plants like hydrilla and all submerged hydrophytes. So the diffusion only takes place, no, through the general surface. So diffusion is again very important for them. Yeah, understood. So all of these are the significance of diffusion. These are for the significance of the diffusions. Yes. Then let us understand about the permeability. So permeability is the passage, right? The passage is passage of substances is called as its permeability. This is the second joining back.
Recording in progress.
Yeah, so permeability is what the degree of diffusion of gases, liquids, and dissolved substances through membrane. Now, there are different types of membranes. You know, this was always a confusion. There are four types of membranes. There is something called permeable, impermeable, semi-permeable, and differentially permeable. Now, this concept is very important to understand because all of these words, you know, they are related and they are a little confusing. What is the meaning of permeable? We can also call it like freely permeable, right? So like cell wall is freely permeable in plants. So they allow, you know, free movement of, you know, passage of solvent or the solutes. So cell wall in plant cells, filter paper. So the examples of the freely permeable materials, they are the cell wall for plant cells. And it is the pure, you know, cellulose paper. Or filter paper, right? So they are freely permeable. Then what do we mean by the impermeable substances? So the ones, you know, they are, why they are impermeable? Because they are, you know, with deposits of suberin and cutin. So they are deposited by waxy materials like, you know, cutin or suberin, and they do not allow the entry of water or dissolved substances, like, you know, so they are totally like impermeable, like cells of cork or a cuticle. You know, cuticle is the upper layer, you know, that waxy covering. So cuticle layer of the leaf or the, you know, cork cells. So they are like impermeable. They do not allow substances of movement of anything. So I hope you understood the permeable and the impermeable. Yeah, perfect. Good, Rishikesh. Then the semi-permeable and the selectively permeable. So now, when I was in school or when you all were in school, we used to always think, I mean, come on, let's face it, that we used to think that cell membrane is called semi-permeable or selectively permeable. We used to say like the same thing. Who cared in the 8, 9, 10 grade what is the difference between selectively permeable and semi-permeable? But there's a lot of difference. So what is the difference is that these membranes, you know, I'm talking about the semi-permeable, they permit the movement of only solvent but prevent the movement of solutes. So they are called as semi. Semi matlab kya? They only allow certain things to pass, but do not allow certain other things to pass. So solutes, you know, solvents are welcome to pass, but solutes are not allowed. No entry. Right? So only solvents are allowed, but solutes are not allowed. So which are the examples of the semi-permeable membrane? Now here we have the egg membrane, the animal bladder. Colloid membranes, parchment paper. So they only allow certain solutes to pass, no, and does not allow the solvent molecules. The solvent they allow to pass, do not allow the solutes to pass. So they are called as what? They are called as the semi-permeable. And then we have to understand about the selectively or differentially permeable membranes. So they allow selected passage of solutes also and solvent also. So they are like, you know, allowing the passage of solute substances as well as the solvent substances. They allow passage of both some certain solutes and certain solvents. So they are called as what? They are called as the differentially permeable or selectively permeable. Differentially permeable or the selectively permeable. So all the biological membranes, all the membranes involved in the biological things like cell membrane, you know, plasma lemma, I hope you know Newry lemma, Sarko lemma, tonoplast, very, very important MCQ. What is a tonoplast, guys? Vacuole, the single covering of vacuole is called as a tonoplast. One of the favorite questions to come for the MCQs. Covering of vacuole is a tonoplast. It is the vacuole ka covering. Yep, and the membranes surrounding the subcellular organelles also, like, you know, they are also permeable. There is one, yes, I want to see where we use this. Let's see who will answer. So guys, there is a non-living. Are all, you know, selectively permeable membranes living only, like biological only, like cell membrane, plasma lemma, Newry lemma, Sarko lemma, or the tonoplast. There is one non-living also, which acts as a selectively permeable membrane, which is cellophane tube. Where did we use this? Let's see who will answer. Where did we use the cellophane?
Yeah, guys. So what would be the answer? Cellophane. Where we had used the cellophane, come on, you should know this. Cellophane, kaha use kiya tha, cellophane tube. It was used in hemodialysis. Do you remember the blood was taken out and it was passed through a cellophane tube? Cellophane tube is a selectively permeable. So it only allows certain things to go out, which were the certain things that it was allowing to go out. What? The urea, right? The urea and the extra water. So it was allowing solutes, no? It was allowing urea to go out. So solutes as well as extra water, that is a solvent. So that's how the blood was filtered. Same, are you remembering? Yeah, so guys, if you see here, no, clearly that you see here, this is the cellophane. Here, this is the cellophane tube. You see, the blood is taken out from a person and it is passed through this particular tube. No, this tubing is a cellophane tube. So it's going to allow, see, it's written also, it is a selectively permeable membrane.
So allowing the passage of the certain substances while preventing the others. So you see here. So certain things get diffused, certain things don't get diffused. Correct. So now so this is relatively or the differentially permeable. Okay, then they've explained about osmosis. Osmosis is what we want to see later on. Right, plasmolysis. All these things will come. Yeah, see. We talked about the water potential, right? So all these water potential, solute potential, pressure potential. So under fully turgid cells, so let's see here, under fully, this is the equation, right? Water potential is equal to the osmotic potential plus the pressure potential. Osmotic potential means solute potential. Osmotic potential is a solute potential. Sometimes that can result in zero also. As I told you, sometimes it can be minus 10 plus 10. So answer might be zero also. So in case of fully turgid cell, right? In the case of fully turgid cell, the water potential will invariably be zero. So this is a very important question. In case of a fully turgid cell, the water potential will invariably be zero. And in the other cases, like, you know, in case of a flaccid cell, the water potential will always be negative. So in them it will be negative. Yep, so let's just solve few MCQs from what we have done today. Yeah, so can you answer MCQ number 15? Answer question number 15. Which one of the following doesn't help in molecule transport? So which of the following, you know, does not help in the transport of molecules? Diffusion, osmosis, surface tension, or active transport? Guys, it is very easy. Yes, anyone? It will be definitely surface tension, right? The answer has to be surface tension, because diffusion, osmosis, active transport, they all help in transportation. Surface tension should be the answer. Yeah, so please try MCQ number 6. It was asked in AFMC, CETs, JEEs. So selective permeability identifies the process of transmission through semi-permeable membrane is called as, or the movement of higher water potential to low water potential through a semi-permeable membrane is called as. Guys, I don't think this is tough. Very good, Ansh and Sameeksha. You're correct. It is B. Yes, water. No, so whenever it is water, it is osmosis. Whenever it is water, it is osmosis. Okay, so you completed this. Other MCQs are like, you know, we have to do the theory for that. So we shall continue this the next time, right? Osmosis, mainly MCQs revolve around the osmosis. So they're mainly revolving around the osmosis part. So we would be continuing them.
Okay, so guys, I hope you understood everything taught, right? So lots of important things we discussed, lots of, you know, main points, lots of important concepts we discussed in the today's session, water potential, you know, the osmosis. So we will be continuing this in the next lecture. So next lecture, we'll continue this same chapter. We will go further to osmosis, transpiration, and the, you know, the further main parts. Any question, anything you want to ask me? All right, cool. So thank you guys. And I hope to see you soon back. So please read the chapter well, revise the chapter well. I'll see you on the other side. Take care. Bye-bye. See you. Be safe. Bye, all of you all. Thank you. Okay, bye-bye.